So welcome you all for joining the EZ 104 course, that is Azure Administrator Associate Level course for getting started with something new. So welcome you all for joining up for the day and wishing you all to have a great learning experience and ongoing career success. And about myself, my name is Ranjit Kumar and I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer and as well as I'm a Microsoft Certified Professional. I do hold a 5+ years of experience and I just worked on different fields like in networking, compute solution, and as well as in the on-premises workloads, and even with the the public cloud environments like Amazon Web Services and Microsoft Azure and as well as GCP. So I just worked in different fields all throughout my 5 years, and as well as I'm just currently delivering the courses, like starting from Azure courses, like from EZ 900, that is Azure Fundamentals, to EZ 104 Azure Associate, and EZ 700, that is Network Solutions, and EZ 500 Security Solutions, and all the way to expert level courses like EZ 305, that is Solution Architect course, and as well as EZ 400 DevOps Solutions. And additionally, I'm also delivering some security series like SE 100 and SE 900, SE 300 as well. So these were the few things I'm just currently delivering the courses. And obviously, that's all a quick introduction about myself. And as I said earlier, this course has a prerequisites. That's not something we are going to start from the scratch. It is an associate level course, and obviously you guys are being working from an IT firm. Definitely you guys would have a basic understanding upon all the things. For example, understanding of on-premises virtualization technology, including how VMs, virtual network, and virtual hard disk are going to work. An understanding upon network configuration, including TCP/IP, domain name system, VPNs, firewalls, and encryption technologies. Understanding of Active Directory concepts, such as how to create users, managing groups, and role-based access control. And at last, understanding of resiliency and disaster recovery, then includes backup and restore operation. So Azure says these were the basic prerequisites you need to have. And I'm not going to ask you that. You need to have all the whatever the things we have discussed on this slide. I don't want everyone to have all the in-depth level of knowledge. I'm pretty much sure that you guys would have a basic understanding upon most of the things. I don't want to have each and everyone to know all the technologies to the in-depth level of concept. I just want to have you guys to have a basic understanding. If you guys do have a basic understanding upon whatever listed over here, you guys are good to go for this course. If you say, no, I'm not even aware of what is on-premises technologies, I'm not even aware of what is networking, the TCP, IP, domain, DNS, firewalls, and encryption, and I'm not even aware of Active Directory, and I'm not even aware of how we can just go and start working on it, then it might be hard for you. But you guys are working in IT firm, definitely you guys would have a basic understanding upon it. And I hope you guys all got to have this, so we don't have any issues in getting started with this course. And once you're done with the course, what you will do? Successful Azure administrator start this role with experience in operating system, virtualization, cloud infra, storage structures, and networking. As the main part of Azure administrator is something, you need to start working with networking, compute, security, and as well as storage. These were the four major activities you need to start working on. We will guide you. What exactly you're going to do, you see? As a successful cloud architect, once you're done with the course, a cloud administrator manage the cloud services like storage. You'll be taking care of storage activities. You'll be taking care of network activities. And you'll be taking care of compute capabilities with deep understanding upon each service across the full IT lifecycle. Right now, you do not have any much clear understanding upon what are the compute options, network options, and storage options. But obviously, once you're done with the course, you will have a good level and deep level of understanding upon each and every services. Then, once you are aware of the most of the technologies, you need to decide which one that suits the best for you. And as you are a cloud admin, you are going to take request from the user, end user request for building up the new application. And you're going to give you some recommendation of how you can optimize the performance and scale, and as well as how you can provision it, capacity, monitor, and adjust appropriate. So only if you have gone ahead and done with the course, and obviously you are already in the part of completing the course, and once you're done with that, up next you would understand which compute requirement or which tool like the storage or networking is going to be right fit for your customer workflow. And then you are going to decide how you can optimize the performance without increasing the cost. You will get to know how you can reduce the cost and how you can increase the performance. Everything you will get to know, and you are going to start working on it. Once you're done with the course, once you start working dedicatedly as a cloud admin, these are the few things you will do. And also, cloud admins use Azure portal. Something very important. Whenever we talk about deploying and managing the resource, first people will start working with Azure portal. Everyone, whoever, even I, like anyone, would start something first in the Azure portal. And once you have become more proficient in the Azure portal, then you may consider using PowerShell on the command line interface tool. It is not something you can go and deploy and manage the resource everything in one day on the Azure portal. You can manage in Azure portal, you can manage in PowerShell, and you can manage in command interface. But something you would, first you need to become more proficient on the Azure portal. Only if you got to understand about how the resources are going to work and what is the deployment model, what were the types, only then you can start working with PowerShell and command line interface. So first, make sure you become strong on the Azure portal. And then successful cloud administrator, start with control with experiencing operating system, virtualization, cloud infra storage, and networking. This is what something you are dedicatedly going to do. And you may also ask me, okay, I'm just planning for the certification. What were the prerequisites? No prerequisites. In order to start with this AZ-104 Microsoft Azure Administrative Associate course, you do not have any prerequisite in starting up with this course. Even you have completed this AZ-900 or you haven't completed this AZ-900, that's fine. If you have been completed AZ-900, perfectly fine. If you say no, you haven't been completed this AZ-900, even that is perfectly fine. Even you haven't completed this AZ-900, you're still eligible for taking up this course. No prerequisites. If you are having it, great. If you don't have it, no problem. You can still go and take this certification. What you're going to do as an Azure admin, you are going to implement, monitor, maintain, what were the things? Compute, storage, network, and security. These were the four major things you'll be start working on. Compute, storage, networking, and security, in which you are going to implement and monitor it. This is what the dedicated workload for you for being an Azure Administrative Associate. And once you are done with this AZ-104 course, you may say, I want to go to the next level. I just want to have even more knowledge. Then you may consider going with AZ-305. AZ-305 is something, the expert level course. It is designed for solution architect who create solutions, who is going to create the solutions for compute, network, storage, and security. But in order to get started with this course, you need to have this prerequisite. Only if you have been cleared with this certification, you're eligible to take this expert level course. This is 1-star, 2-star, and 3-star. Working with this 2-star, no prerequisite required. But going with 3-star, you are in need of one prerequisite of 2-star. Only if you have any 2-star courses, certification, you are eligible for taking up this 3-star. So this is what the certification journey. Obviously, once you're done with the course, you guys are eligible for taking up the certification, and I will guide you what were the steps that is involved for taking up the certification. On the last day, I will also guide you like what were the tips and tricks required for clearing your examination and what were the mock tests you want to take. Most of the information I will just let you know on our last day. If you are planning for certification, again, you need to start focusing on this particular study areas. You can see each study area has a different weightage. Manage Azure IoTs and governance has 15-20% of weightage. Implement and manage storage, 15-20%. Deploy and manage Azure compute resources, 20-25%. configure and manage virtual network 25 to 30. Monitoring and backup resource 10 to 15. So what does this weightage really mean to say? The higher the weightage, you say 25 to 30%, you can get most of the questions on this particular study area. Up next, the second priority, 20 to 25, you may get less number of questions. First priority, second, and third. Just do consider as the third priority, and the last priority is the 10 to 15. The greater the weightage you see, the more the question you can expect on your examination. So we would recommend you to, if you are planning for the certification, just go ahead and start focusing on this way. Having a higher weightage, you are going to get more questions and you can easily go ahead and get more questions on your examination. You can easily go ahead and get most of the correct answer and you can score very well. So we would recommend to take and work in this priority ways. And obviously, on the last day, I will just guide you. Obviously, when we discuss this slide on our last day, you will get to have a more clear understanding. So on the time, on the last day, again, I will just guide you with some of the tips and tricks for clearing up your examination. What were the modules we are going to discuss? We got to have 11 modules to go. Starting from identity, governance and compliance. Azure resource, how you can just go and manage your resources using different tool sets. Virtual networking, inter-site connectivity, network traffic management, Azure storage, virtual machine, pass compute option, data production, and monitoring. We got to have 11 modules. 11 modules will guide you like all the basics of, and all, not only the basics, and all the intermediate level of administrator, all the things you will get to have an ability to learn on this course. This lesson includes starting from identity and all the way to monitoring. You got to have all the entire package involved here. So this is what something the course will help you to understand with the different kind of segments like compute, storage, identity, and as well as monitoring, and even the security. You will get to have almost all the things in this particular course. And we are in the module one. So module one is all about identity. Module one is all about identity. So what exactly we are going to discuss in this particular module? We got to have two lessons to discuss. We will first talk about what is exactly Azure Active Directory. And second lesson, we will discuss what is exactly users and group accounts. And we got to have one more lesson. One more lesson is something we will go ahead and talk about the lab. And I'm not going to help you out with the lab. So I've been already guided you. So like how the way and which way you need to perform your labs exactly using the same way you need to perform it. And we will give you some time later in the second half. In the second half, I will just guide you how we can perform this lab activity. Over here, we got to have two modules to go. We are on module one. And once we are done with module one, we will be jumping with the module two. And I'm not going to give you some time right away over here. We will go ahead and cover module one and as well as module two. And then we will go ahead and discuss with you will go ahead and start working with the lab. So we are not going to give you some time. Once we are done with this two lesson, we are going to get started. You're going to get started with the lab after completion of both the modules. So let's go ahead and get started all over here. So getting started with this lesson one, first we got to have something called as Azure Active Directory benefits and feature. First you need to understand what is this Azure Active Directory's benefits and features. And then you need to understand what were the AD concepts. And then we want to have a discussion between what is your on-premises Active Directory to Azure Active Directory. And then we need to understand about different kind of editions, the licensing plans. And then we will talk about AD device identity, like how you can just go and register your device to Azure Active Directory and how you can join your own device. We will discuss. And then we will discuss about one particular feature called the self-service password reset. So this is what the exact things we are going to discuss in this particular lesson. First and foremost thing, let's try to understand what is this Azure Active Directory. if you guys already worked on your on-premises Active Directory, you might may have an experience upon what is Active Directory. And more similarly, however you work on your on-premises Active Directory, it is more similar to that. Azure Active Directory is more similar to your on-premises Active Directory. However, using your Windows Server Active Directory, what you do? Which is something you got to have on your premises where you are using this Windows Server Active Directory, you are going to start storing your user information, group information, for authentication, for authorization, you are going to use this Windows Server Active Directory. Similarly, if you are using Azure Active Directory, you are going to do the same. If I talk about Azure Active Directory, you are going to do the same. User account, group accounts, authentication, authorization, you are going to use it here. But when we talk about Windows Server Active Directory, it is something we store on our premises. We store dedicatedly on our on-premises, and which supports only these two different kind of protocols, Kerberos and NDLM-based authentication protocols. But when we talk about Azure Active Directory, it is not something stored on your on-premises, it is being stored on the cloud. You can access this particular features anywhere and anytime. And the best part here, Azure Active Directory supports different kind of authentication and authorization protocols to access these resources. And this Azure Active Directory, it is a cloud-based identity tool. And we used to call Azure Active Directory as a multi-tenant cloud-based identity. You can have multiple tenants and you can create in minutes. If you want to have a multi-tenant cloud-based identity solution, we got to have Azure Active Directory. Azure Active Directory is one of the cloud-based suite for identity management capabilities, where you can go and start access your users, groups, authentication, authorization information all over here. And the best part of Azure Active Directory, it has so much of features. For example, it has single sign-on. Azure Active Directory got to have single sign-on. And the best part of this Azure Active Directory supports hybrid environment. What is hybrid? If you are already having your on-premises Active Directory, you just want to synchronize your users and groups from your on-premises to Azure. Azure Active Directory supports your hybrid authentication. Azure Active Directory provides your application management, authentication, authorization, user management, group management, device management. If you want to bring back your own device, you need to register and you want to join to Azure Active Directory for single sign-on and so much more benefits. You got to have here. So, at last, it's about identity, hybrid entity. Like you can bring back your on-premises Active Directory to Azure and you can make it synchronized. Your users, whatever you have on your premises, you may use the same users on this Azure Active Directory right away, accessing it anywhere, anytime. The best part of the cloud-based identity is something you can access it anywhere and anytime. And which got to have so much of benefits. When we talk about Azure Directory, it has single sign-on. It works with iOS, macOS, Android, and Windows devices. And it is going to protect your on-premise web applications with secure remote access. And you can extend your Active Directory to the cloud. And you can protect your sensitive information and applications. And you can reduce your cost and enhance security with self-service capabilities. For example, self-service password and so on and so forth. We got to have here. So that we can just reduce the human intervention we got to have here. So these were the few benefits and features. And again, I will explain you what were the benefits and features in our upcoming lesson. We are not going to have just a few benefits and feature. We got to have plenty of benefits and feature. Let's go and discuss one by one. But before that, you need to understand what is this Azure AD concepts. What is an identity? An object can be authenticated. An identity can be a user with username and the password. Identity also includes, identity is not something we define it for just the username and the password. Identities also include applications or other servers that might require authentication through secrets or certificates. That is what something we used to call identity. What is an account? An identity that has the data associated with the identity, as we had discussed. It may be username or password, it may be application or server that has a data associated with it. And remember, you can't have an account without an identity. You need to have an account only with identity, like either your username or your applications or servers. You need to have one. What is this Azure AD account then? An identity created through Azure Active Directory or other Microsoft Cloud service. It may be you can create your identity. For example, you want to create a brand new user. You can create an identity in your Azure Active Directory. Azure Active Directory supports creating your identities. Can be done over here. For example, you want to associate and register your application. All you can do with just with the Azure Active Directory. Or even you say you don't want to create your identities in Azure AD. You can also go and start working with the Microsoft Cloud Service. What with the Microsoft Cloud Service, such as M365? Identity is whatever that is stored on Azure Active Directory and accessible to your organization cloud service and the subscription. This account also sometimes called as like work account or the school account. What are the IDs we got to have here and stored on Azure Active Directory? And then a very important thing, when we talk about Azure AD, tenant or directory. This time, I want to make you understand one small thing. There is mostly the people who are just getting started, they may have a confusion between what is this tenant and what is this directory. There were some questions asked, what is the code difference between tenant versus directory? Just want to answer this. Sometimes we used to call tenant. Sometimes we used to call directory. To be honest, tenant and directory are same. The term tenant and directory are often used interchangeably. Sometimes we used to call tenant, sometimes we used to call directory. Both are exactly the same. So don't get confused between what is tenant and what is directory. Okay, sometimes we used to call tenant, sometimes we used to call directory. There is something you need to remember this. First of all, whenever you are going to sign up for a subscription, let's say if you are planning for creating a free trial account, where you can do that, if you go for Azure.com and once you hit here, it is going to ask you if you're just getting started for a very first time, you can just go and select on this free account and select start for free. You are going to get one free account created for you. But just go and start filling up the information, and once it is done, you are ready to go and create your free account. This is what the steps that has been included. But anyhow, I'm not going to do that. We'll share you this link if you're interested to start creating your free account of your choice. But something, just for the lab enrollment, you mean you want to create a free account? You don't want to do that. For just performing the lab enrollment, we got to have a dedicated enrollment for the scalable environment. We used to call this as scalable environment. You got to have here, you no longer require just for performing the lab, you don't want to create a free account. Later on, you say you want to create a free account for exploring more, then you may consider going and creating a free account. And whenever you are going to create a free account, remember one thing, a dedicated and trusted instance of Azure Active Directory, a tenant is automatically created when your organization signs up for Microsoft Cloud Service subscription. Free trial is something, a free subscription. It is one subscription. Whenever you are going to get started with this free account, you are going to get $200 that has been credited to your account, and you can use it for the first 30 days. This is one type of subscription. Whenever you go and sign up for a subscription, automatically an AD tenant has been created for you whenever you create it. And how does it going to look like? For example, this is how it is exactly going to look like. With the name of default directory, whenever I go and sign up for any subscription, it may be free trial subscription, it may be Azure Pass, Azure for Students. There are plenty of subscription options available. Whenever I'm going to sign up for the subscription, automatically one tenant will be created for me with the name of default directory. And even if I search about this AAD, we used to call AAD in a shorter form, Azure Active Directory. Whenever you hit AAD, you're going to get this option available. So selecting upon this Azure Active Directory, you see whenever I'm going to create and sign up for a subscription, one default directory will be created for me. With the name default directory, 110 will be created for me. And whatever the email ID I used to sign up for the subscription, whenever you hit on start free, it is going to ask you to sign up. Whatever the email ID you provided here, using that email ID, one domain will be created for you. In my case, I provided this particular email ID, ranjit-kumar-r@outlook.com. Using that particular thing, I've used Outlook credentials. ranjit-kumar-r@outlook.onmicrosoft.com. This is what something. Microsoft created a domain for me using my email ID, .onmicrosoft.com. One domain has been created for me. For you, for anyone who signs up for the subscription, they are going to get this tenant automatically created with the name default directory, with a unique tenant ID, and what are the email ID they provided, it is going to start having it available here. And obviously, whenever you're creating this tenant, you're going to get the license called as AD free. We'll let you know what about this license. But remember, whether something automatically created for you, you no longer require to go out and create a tenant. By default, whenever you sign up for the subscription, automatically you're going to get one tenant created for you with the name of default directory, with your email ID as your primary domain ID will be created for you. Additional instance of Azure Active Directory can be created. As I said, you remember Azure Active Directory is a multi-tenant cloud-based identity. So why do you want to have multiple tenants? So what is exactly the tenant? So this is what the tenant, this tenant, that is a default directory, this tenant hold this users, this groups, and this application place. This tenant holds this information in place. But I want to say, I want to have an isolated environment. I don't want the 7 users or 4 groups or this 21 application want to communicate from a different tenant. I'm just, let's assume I'm running a company. It is a multinational company. I don't want, let's say a multinational company has been located in different part of the world, in South India, in West India, or in Central India. Let's say this is located in South India. I just want to create another one tenant for the Central India. I don't want the South Indian users or groups to be accessible over here. If I want to have a high level of isolation, I can go ahead and start creating multi-tenant environment. I can create multiple tenants if I want to have 1, 2, 3 or even more possible. I can go ahead and start working on it, which is perfectly fine. I can create a multi-tenant environment. You may also have a question. So how many tenants I can create it? We'll let you know. That is always a limitation. I want you guys to keep this link handy with you. You know why? This limits are something frequently it is going to be updated. Last updated 21st November 2022. 21st November 2022, it's been last updated. So what you need to take into consideration here, you know, if you want to know, like, as I said, you can create multiple tenants. You may have a question, how many tenants I can create? Or if I say you can have one or more subscription, you may have a question, how many subscriptions I can have in one single account? And you may have a different kind of limitation related questions. I never ask you to memorize the limitation because Azure will frequently change the limitation. Frequently, Azure is going to change the limitation. If you are sticking with this limitation, there is a chance. There is a chance the limitation might be changed. It will be frequently updated. So always keep the link handy with you. You want to know what is a management group's limitation. That's what the management group limitation. Subscription limitation and resource limitation, template limitation, Azure Active Directory limitation. Here we go. A tenant A single user can belong to 500 Azure AD tenants as a member or a guest. A single user can create maximum 200 directories. If you want to ask me how many directories I can create, I can create 200. So on and so forth, each and every single thing, we got to have a limitation. It has been characterized with the alphabetical order, and we keep going on. So if you want to know the exact limitation of a particular service, always use this link handy with you. This link will help you to understand what is the exact limitation, quota, and constraints. Here we got how. You see here, starting from here, all the way, you see, just keep going. There are so much of resources available, and even you got to have even more. So just keep the link handy with you, which is really going to help you. So if you ask me, like, do you want to have a multi-tenant cloud, and how many multi-tenant you can create in the cloud? You got to have a limitation of creating 200 for one single user. And even again, I said, why do you want to create multiple tenants? It's going to give you a high level of isolation. If I go back to this default directory, you can see I have 7 users, 4 groups, 21 applications, and no devices found. But if I go to some other tenant, for example, I will switch to a different tenant. Let's say I will just go with this ABC tenant. Let me show you. I would go ahead and switch to this ABC tenant. And here is an option. If I click on switch, it will be moved to this ABC tenant, and this tenant will no longer have the same users or same groups or same devices or same application, which has a different name that we all know, a different domain name, different users, different group information. Nothing else is exactly the same. Remember, if you want to have a multi-tenant cloud and you want to have a high level of isolation from one to another, consider to choose to create multiple tenants. Anytime you want to create multiple tenants, you got to have a leverage of doing it. So it will be useful whenever you're having an organization that has been placed on different regions, or you have a different requirement, you want to have a high level of isolation from one tenant to another tenant, you may consider creating additional instances. And again, Azure AD is an underlying product providing an IT service. In Azure, we got to have Azure AD. It is an underlying product for providing IT service. The term tenant means single instance of Azure AD representing single organization. We also used to refer as the Govert tenant. We used to refer it as organization. Let's say organization name ABC, default directory is an organization, test is something an organization. We used to refer in this way. That's what something you need to know. And remember one more thing. Subscription. Whatever the resources you are going to deploy, like let's say whenever you're going to deploy your virtual machine, storage account, load balancer, whatever you deploy, which is something you need to have a subscription. Only if you have a subscription, you're allowed to go and start creating the resources. Azure Active Directory is an underlying service providing for the identity service. If you want to have the username and the password, and if you want to have for authentication authorization, you need to have an Azure Active Directory. But only if you have a subscription, you are allowed to deploy these resources. Resource groups, virtual network, load balancer, storage, virtual machine, and so on and so forth. Only if you have a subscription, you're allowed to go ahead and start working on it. You might not going to get the clear exact thing what I'm trying to say, but don't worry. We got to have next module. Dedicatedly, we will discuss about what a subscription and how to start working on it. On the time, you will get to have a clear-cut solution. But as of now, just try to consider subscription as the one used to deploy the resources. And subscription is the one that is recommended for paying the resources. Whatever the resource you deploy, for example, you create one VM, two VM, whatever the resource you created is going to incur the charges. All the charges from the subscription you need to pay for it. Just remember these information. All right. The next good comparison, you may have a query. What is this ADDS? Like, it seems like more likely like ADDS. Azure Active Directory seems like more likely like ADDS, but it has more benefits. Azure Active Directory got to have so much of benefits compared to ADDS. First of all, Azure is a primary and IT solution. We know very well. And since it has been used let's say over the internet. So it has been set up over here. Set up over the HTTP and HTTPS communication. Remember, all the Azure Active Directory has similarity, many similarities to ADDS. There are many differences. It is important to realize that using Azure Active Directory is different from deploying an Active Directory domain controller on the VM and adding it to your on-premises. When we talk about the comparison, most likely it is more similar. Seems like more similar ADDS and Azure Active Directory, but not exactly the same. It's been queried over HTTP and TPS communication because it has been something. Let's say queried over the internet-based applications. But whereas when you talk about ADDS, which is something kept on the on-premises, it no longer requires HTTP and TPS communication. Instead, it uses LDAP. Azure Active Directory uses HTTP and TPS based. It cannot be queried over LDAP. However, ADDS has been queried over LDAP. It supports most of the communication protocol because cloud is something open for most of the people. People can use their own preferred protocols, communication protocols. Since Azure Active Directory is HTTP and HTTPS based, it does not use Kerberos. Since it is HTTP and HTTPS based protocol, communication protocol supported by Azure Active Directory, it does not use Kerberos. Instead, it uses SAML, WSFET, OpenID Connect, and for OAuth for the authorization. And also, Azure Active Directory includes so much of federation services like Facebook, Twitter, and so on and so forth. You can go and federate with many third-party services possible. And when you're working with this ADDS, you might be working with OUs and GPOs. But over here in this Azure Active Directory, you do not have any of this feature. It's all being created on a flat structure. What does this flat structure means? We'll let you know. We are going to start working with the users and the groups on the time. We'll let you know what is exactly mean by this flat structure. And when I talk about this Azure Active Directory, as I said, it got to have so much of benefits. Let me explain you what were those benefits. Remember one thing. Whenever you are going to create a subscription, as I said, whenever you go and sign up for the subscription, automatically the stand has been created for you. But whenever it's been automatically created with the name, with your email ID, the tenant domain name will be created. But here you will see there is something called as Azure AD free license. That is what something you see. The license is the one which is going to define you some features and benefits. Whenever if I go with the free license, you see I'm in the free. By default, everyone is going to avail this free license. Whenever you go with free, you are going to get 500,000 objects you can store in this free license. A single sign-on has been unlimited. It has this many benefits. If you talk about Azure Active Directory, it has directory objects, single sign-on, core entity and access, B2B collaboration, identity and access for Office 365, premium features, hybrid entity, so on and so forth. But remember, you need to go and start choosing the different license to go and avail all these benefits. If you're in the free, it doesn't mean that only you're going to get these four benefits. Let me show you what are those. How to check what are the license you got to have for free and for the premium. Here in Azure portal, here you will get to have a clear understanding. I'm in default directory and started the license tab. Once I start the license tab, if I set in the license features, here it will let me know. My organization has Azure Directory free license. The current plan for this Azure Directory organization is set to free. If I do have one is a free license, you see that? I get the directory objects. I can have single sign-on, user provisioning, federated authentication, ADFS or third party, it's been supported as we had discussed. User management, group management, device registration, cloud authentication, AD Connect Sync, self-service password reset, so on and so forth. Just if you have the free license, by default, everyone is going to get the free license. They are going to get all those features, whatever it's AS, PIL, AAD, features for guest users, you can go and avail it. starting from directory objects and all the way, you can go ahead and avail all those benefits. But something you want to do with the company branding, you need to have Office 365 or P1 or P2 license. Either have Office 365, P1 or P2 license. If you want to do multi-factor authentication, group access management, service level agreement, either way is you need to have either of the subscription. But let's say, even though you have Office 365 subscription, if you wish you want to protect, if you want to go ahead and start working with banned password, password protection feature, you want to turn it on, it requires premium P1. If you have Office 365 license all the way from directory objects and all the way to device write back, you got to have a leverage of availing all those features and benefits. But if you wish you want to start working with the password protection, only if you have a P1 license, only if you have a P1 or P2 license, you're going to avail this. Or even though you have P1 license, if you want to start working with this last four, identity protection, privilege anti-management, access reviews, and entitlement management, only if you have the P2 license, only if you have a premium P2 license, you're going to avail these four benefits. And whoever got to have the premium P2 license, they are going to get all these benefits. But remember, Azure AD, free license comes at free of cost. You no longer require to pay any single amount if you are utilizing all these features.